Good afternoon. I'm Barry Friedman, and this is the forum. And we are going to talk about the upcoming and past term of the Supreme Court. I thought I'd say one word of introduction thematically about the court, and then I will introduce the panel. We are going to follow what we try to have be forum rules and do all the talking up here within about 35 minutes, so there's lots of time for your questions, though we have lots of interesting things and themes and things to talk about. So we're heading into the ninth year of the Roberts Court, and I thought it was interesting to reflect for just a moment on some of the Chief Justice's goals when he became the Chief Justice. Not all Chief Justices have a set of goals when they become Chief Justice, but this one did. He felt that the court was viewed too ideologically. He thought that the court was too fractured. He hoped to bring more consensus to the court, more people signing on to opinions and less disagreeing with one another, particularly along ideological lines. He purported to be a minimalist, thinking that the court should do less in cases rather than more, and also that precedents should be respected. And I throw all of that out because I suspect that in the course of our conversation today, there will be some commentary on whether the Chief Justice is achieving those goals or not. We have three wonderful speakers, and I'm going to introduce, I have very long bios for all of them, but I'm going to introduce them very briefly in the order in which they're going to speak. So first, we're going to hear from Adam Liptak, who is to my far left and your right. Adam is the Supreme Court correspondent for the New York Times, and before that did a fascinating column that I missed called Sidebar. In the Times, Adam, as I was saying to him yesterday, has a very great nose for sort of an interesting story about the law. Next, we're going to hear on my right from Debo Adegbile, who has been litigating voting rights cases, including two of the big ones that have been up to the court. He was with the NAACP Legal and Education Fund for several years, litigating, legal director, and running the fund for a while, and now he we're just having a fascinating conversation, is working with the Judiciary Committee in the U.S. Senate, in part trying to undo what the Supreme Court did in the Shelby County case. So we'll hear from him. And finally, on my immediate left is Lauren Goldman. Lauren is the head of litigation for Mayor Brown worldwide. I wonder if that's different than international. I was wondering as I read your bio. And she's also quite an accomplished litigator who's been following the business docket of the court. I do want to say with great pleasure that this is the first forum I have hosted that has two NYU alums on the panel to my left and right. So welcome, everyone. And Adam, why don't you start?
Thank you, Barry. Thank you for having me back at the forum. I apologize for not being an NYU alum. But I'm delighted to be here with Debo and Lauren, who are very sophisticated and will correct my many mistakes. So I thought we'd look back at the term just concluded for a second and then maybe forward. And I tried to think about what are the themes that run through the three great cases decided in the last week of June: Monday, affirmative action; Tuesday, voting rights; Wednesday, same-sex marriage. That's a pretty good week for a journalist. And as I tried to find a theme, I found that my theme came from perhaps the mildest thing Justice Scalia has ever written, not in one of those cases, but in a Fourth Amendment case called Maryland against King. He wrote in dissent of the majority opinion that the opinion does not really contain what you would call a rule of decision, which is to say, as you know, Supreme Court decisions do two things. They resolve a particular dispute, and they announce the general principle that will apply in many other cases. And when you look at these three big cases, none of them did both things. One of them, the affirmative action case, set out a rule of decision. Seemed to me, Debo may disagree, that it tightened up what strict scrutiny meant in the context of race-conscious admissions, and then it went ahead not to apply that rule. Okay, it sent it back down to the Fifth Circuit, and we may find out whether the University of Texas Affirmative Action Program is constitutional or not. More interestingly, importantly, and dishearteningly, there were results in the Voting Rights and Defense of Marriage Act cases, but it's very hard to discern the rule of decision. So in the Voting Rights Act case, the court said, 5-4, that it's not fair to treat some states differently than other states based on quite old data, and require some states, turning federalism upside down, to come to Washington after they enact a law and get permission from the Justice Department or a three-judge court in Washington before their duly enacted sovereign law becomes law. Okay, you know, that sounds plausible on its face. It's a little hard to know, though, not only what standard of review was being employed. There was a question about whether it was rational basis or congruent and proportional, but even what constitutional provision was being invoked. Because this notion of equal sovereignty of the states is missing in the Constitution. It may be a perfectly good concept, but it seems to me to come out of nowhere. And moreover, as Justice Stevens wrote in the New York Review, if you're a legislator, long ago data, you have substantial change in the South, you have a reelected African-American president, you have some of these issues. It may well be that you want to vote against the renewal of the Voting Rights Act. But the constitutional provisions that matter here, the 14th and 15th Amendments, specifically authorize Congress to do the work in this area. Why? Because those amendments were passed in the wake of Dred Scott. Congress didn't, and the people didn't trust the court to make these judgments. And yet here's the court announcing this decision, but not telling us what the rule of decision was. Similarly, in the Defense of Marriage Act case, where the court strikes down that part of the Defense of Marriage Act which denied federal benefits to married same-sex couples in those states where same-sex marriage is lawful, a lot of people in this room probably think that's a pretty good decision. But I challenge you to find, again, the standard of review. Was it rational basis or something more exacting? Or the constitutional provision that Justice Kennedy relied on. There was some talk of federalism in the decision, some talk of equal protection, some talk of due process. And it was mushy enough that two of the dissenters couldn't agree what this means for bans on same-sex marriage in states. So Scalia says, well, if you read this decision, it inevitably means state bans are going to fall. And Chief Justice Roberts says, well, if you read this decision with its emphasis on federalism, meaning this is an issue for the states, it plainly means state bans don't need to fall. So again, I think there's a question of judicial craftsmanship, whether we can't demand a little bit more of our Supreme Court that they actually decide cases and they actually decide the principles that they're using in the process. The other quick theme I might run through these same cases is one Rick Hassett in Slate Magazine framed this the following way. Are the liberals on the court savvy or suckers? By which he meant that the Voting Rights Act case relied very heavily on a four-year-old case called Northwest Austin, which Debo argued, where eight justices, including all of the liberals, signed on to a decision that really laid the groundwork, it seemed to me, for what happened in Shelby County. And you ask, what were they thinking? Why did they sign on to that language? Justice Ginsburg, in an interview a few weeks ago, told me that she now regrets having signed on to the language, even though she was okay with the result in the case. And then similarly, in the affirmative action case, all of the liberals sign on to what seems to me to be some tightening of strict scrutiny in the context of holistic race-conscious admissions. And there only Justice Ginsburg dissents, suggesting that maybe she learned a lesson. Maybe, as Barry was saying, if we have a Chief Justice who's savvy, I don't know if he's a minimalist, but he's an incrementalist, where he's taking things step by step, you may not want to help him every step of the way. And then to look forward a little bit, obviously we've had two terms in a row with incredible blockbusters ending up the term, with healthcare last year, the three cases I just discussed this year. And you might think the Supreme Court would take a breather, but as this is the season of Supreme Court preview panels, and Irv Gorenstein at Georgetown made a nice point the other day. He said the coming term is deeper in important cases than either of the previous two, and that seems right to me. There are a lot of cases, if the last term was about equality, the next term is about structural issues like campaign contribution limits, a kind of a sequel to Citizens United, like the president's recess appointments power, like whether Michigan voters are allowed to ban race-conscious admissions and hiring practices in their state, legislative prayer. And then, the court hasn't taken it yet, but almost certainly will, there's like this fantastic trifecta journalistic, big heaping toffee deliciousness of a case, the contraception mandate in the Affordable Care Act, which brings together Obamacare back at the court, and the issue, do corporations have free exercise rights as they have free speech rights, and sex, and religion? I mean, it couldn't be better, and the sooner they take it, the better. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. I may pop back to you to ask you to tell us a little bit more about some of those cases, but Debo?
Thank you. It's good to be back home at NYU with all of you. Years ago when I sat in this room for a lecture that was given by Derek Bell, who shared a little bit with the 1Ls about what his career had been like, I certainly didn't expect to come back and be sitting here talking to you about some of the cases in which I've been involved, but like Forrest Gump, if you just keep running, you never know where you might end up. So I want to take a bit of a look back and then look forward as well. There were two big cases last term that I want to focus on. Adam has mentioned them both. Those would be the Fisher case, the affirmative action case out of the University of Texas, and the second is the Shelby County case, which is near and dear to my heart, as Adam has mentioned. I'll then touch a little bit on the Schutte or Schwett case. I'm not exactly sure how the Michigan restructuring case is pronounced. And then there's a Mount Holly case that I want to call to your attention this term as well, which involves the FHA. So starting with last term first, Fisher could be the case that is described as the what does Grutter mean case. This is something that connects last term to this term, is that the ghost of the Michigan affirmative action cases is still lingering and very active and keeps popping up on the court's docket. In particular, the issue presented in Fisher involved this question of what is the role of race in admissions, in university admissions. And the fascinating thing in the University of Texas case is that it was a rather de minimis use of race that was at stake in the way the program operated. There were a whole range of criteria, and the lower court described the use of race in the University of Texas as being a factor of a factor of a factor. Essentially, what Texas had determined is that because of the court's precedents, the use of race was important in leading the university to have a diverse body, but the court had sufficiently narrowed consideration of race that you had to be very careful doing it. And because of the history in Texas, the use of race had been eliminated for a time, and so that was a state that had a particular understanding of what the impacts are on campus when you take it away altogether. And after the Michigan cases, they brought back this factor of a factor of a factor. There were many of us that thought that this case might not make it to the court, in part because it was the first interpretation of the University of Michigan standard, of the Grutter standard, and there were some questions raised late into the case, all the way up to the Supreme Court, about the standing or justiciability of this case, having to do with a particular plaintiff who had graduated, was preparing to graduate and graduated from another university, and who the university alleged would not have been admitted to the university whether or not race was considered. And so there were some real questions about why the court would grant this vehicle, and yet it did. But as everybody looked for a big ruling that would revisit Michigan, the case did not go out with a bang, but as we've heard, it got sent back. And there is a debate going on about whether the standard has been changed or whether, as I believe, the court essentially just said, no, do what we said the last time, and essentially was just wrapping the lower courts on the hand for giving too much deference to the university's judgment and not applying the appropriate strict scrutiny framework that the court has looked for in a variety of its opinions. I think that the issue that I'll talk about later in Schwett is not exactly the same, though they have sort of they're sort of in the same neighborhood, so everybody thinks of them as similar affirmative action cases, but the legal issue is quite different. It will be important to watch and see what happens in the lower court with Fisher as it's sent back. And the courts have asked for a briefing on a whole list of sort of core questions on the constitutional analysis. And I think that's going to be a very important case to watch and see how it develops, to see whether it winds its way back to the district court for further development of a record. Keep your eye on it, because we know in the business of civil rights that these things don't ever really die. They keep coming back. Moving for a moment to the Voting Rights Act case, the Shelby County case was essentially put the question to the court again, twice in a rather short period of time, about whether or not the heart of the Voting Rights Act was constitutional. Now, there are different provisions of this core piece. I'm not going to bore you with all of them, but essentially what you need to know is that the provision that was at issue in Shelby is really considered one of the most effective civil rights statutes ever passed. On lists of congressional enactments of any kind, the Voting Rights Act is up there as one of the most important congressional enactments of any kind, not just civil rights statutes. And Congress in 2006 went over, took a look to see what progress had been made, and decided to reauthorize this particular preclearance provision, which requires some but not all states to have their voting changes pre-approved before they can go into effect. The idea is that many of the worst actors were subjected to this, many of the worst voting rights violators were subject to this continuing protection, and Congress in the legislative process, which is very important to understanding the nature of the ruling and how broadly it reached, Congress essentially said that two things are true. The one is that a great deal has changed and there has been a great deal of progress, which Congress specifically attributed to the Voting Rights Act being in place. The second point was that although there had been tremendous progress in the face of this rather strong medicine of requiring jurisdictions to pre-approve their voting changes before they can take effect, that there was still continuing discrimination. And so Congress did not rely on an old formula, as you've heard, or as you would believe if you read the decision, but they started with that, and then they looked to see what were the facts on the ground in those jurisdictions that were covered under the preclearance provision of the Voting Rights Act. And what they found is that notwithstanding the strong medicine, there was substantial voting discrimination going on, and that it was important to continue the journey to try and eradicate it, which was the goal that Congress and the court set for itself in the early precedents. I would be remiss if I didn't say that there were four rulings of the Supreme Court that had previously upheld this statute, and so the ruling in Shelby County was quite jarring, though for some not as jarring as it seemed to others, because the court didn't say that the preclearance rule could never be in place. It just singled out the way in which Congress decided which jurisdictions were going to be subject to that special oversight. And it essentially lobbed the ball back to Congress to say, if you can figure out a better way to do it that satisfies us and that better embraces the contemporary situation on the ground, then it's possible, potentially, to go forward with this statute. If not, then the statute comes to the end of the road. So there is an aspect of that decision that seems narrow because it didn't say that it can never happen. It just said, Congress, you didn't do your homework correctly. I should point out that the Senate voted 98-0 in support of that reauthorization, not something that happens too often. In the oral argument, that became a demerit for Congress and a strike against the statute rather than something that should count toward its constitutionality. Zipping forward to the two other cases, I'll begin with that Schwett case. So this is a case that involves the response, again, to the University of Michigan cases. The affirmative action cases out of the University of Michigan resulted in a rule that said race can be used in certain limited ways in college admissions, particularly if it's considered together with other factors. What happened on the ground in Michigan is that a bunch of folks, led by Ward Connerly, put a ballot initiative on the agenda and had a constitutional amendment passed that said, notwithstanding that the consideration of race in admissions is constitutionally permissible, something we know because the court said so in Grutter, we are going to exclude from the political process the ability of the university to consider race by virtue of a constitutional amendment. The case at issue here is a challenge to that constitutional enactment, invoking little-known precedents that suggest that where you restructure government, where you restructure the rules of the game to foist upon, with a racial focus and disadvantage a racial minority group, a special rule obtains that allows those enactments to be viewed under strict scrutiny and to fall away. The Court of Appeals found that this was a restructuring within those precedents and knocked it out. And so now the question comes to the court in, after a series of ballot initiative cases and restructuring cases about whether this particular one is inconsistent with the precedents, and we may see what the court feels about these precedents. Lastly, I want to touch upon this important Fair Housing Act case. One of the most important things in civil rights law is the opportunity to demonstrate discrimination not only through intentional conduct, which the court has interpreted the Reconstruction Amendments to require and that you know from your con law classes, but to be able to ferret out racial discrimination and indeed other types of discrimination through disparate impact. It's essentially showing that there is a disparity that cannot rationally be explained through means other than some racial imbalance, and you look to demonstrate that not only was race at issue, not intentionally, but having an effect, but that more importantly, there were other alternatives. There were less disparate ways to achieve the same end. And this is an important standard that runs through a whole bunch of civil rights statutes. The court, for a second time in two terms, has granted a case, this is a Mount Holly case, where a blighted area was essentially allowed to be redeveloped, an area that was very heavily concentrated with racial minorities, allowed to be redeveloped because it was blighted in a way that would push the housing outside of the reach of the African and American Latino community that lived there. And so essentially to improve the nature of the township, they have decided to rebuild it. You've heard of the Kelo case before about blight and takings power and the like. This is a situation where those citizens came back and said, no, this redevelopment plan puts a special burden on us and will force us to leave our homes and our community, and the disparate impact standard should apply. The court granted the case to determine whether or not disparate impact applies in the context of the Fair Housing Act. And what's important to know about this case, and I'll pause after this and perhaps we can come back to it in questions, is that 11 circuits that have considered this question found that disparate impact applies under the Fair Housing Act. On the other side, you have zero. And as significantly, HUD had just promulgated a regulation suggesting that indeed the disparate impact standard is proper under the Fair Housing Act. And so the United States filed a brief saying, look, whatever you may think about this, this is not the vehicle. This rule has just been promulgated. Let the lower courts work it out. And in any event, perhaps you may want to wait till there's at least some circuit split or some of the circumstances that are typical before the court enters into a case to determine what the rule is. What is significant is that last term there was a similar case which settled and that didn't make it to the court's docket. And so the court seems aggressively determined to reach some of these cases that didn't necessarily have to wind up in the court for various reasons. But the fact that the court is reaching in some circumstances to get to these seminal issues in long-settled law tells you something about the skepticism that the court has for some traditional civil rights protections. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Debo. It's alarming as a moderator to find everybody on the panel adhering to their time limits, but I'm going to go with it. So Lauren's going to talk to us some about the business cases.
I will try to stick to our time limits. It's so much fun to be back here. I loved my time at NYU, and it's always great to come back down here. I wanted to talk briefly about two broad and related topics that have taken up a big chunk of the court's business docket over the last few terms, and I think that will continue into the next few. One is arbitration, and the other is class actions. So just very briefly, arbitration is essentially alternative dispute resolution. Parties contract to take any disputes that might arise out of their relationship to arbitration rather than have them go through the court system. Generally speaking, the decision of the arbitrator is binding and final and should not be challenged in court. The Congress enacted in 1925 something called the Federal Arbitration Act, which creates a body of substantive federal law that governs arbitration. And there's a strong policy in favor of arbitration that's been recognized both by Congress and by the Supreme Court repeatedly. Basically, we like it. It's less expensive, it's faster. It allows people to bring claims that would probably be prohibitively expensive to actually litigate in court, and it relieves the courts, which are already very overburdened, of some of these disputes. And some disputes that are submitted to arbitration are small, and a lot of them are quite large. And it's really become a very valuable part of our dispute resolution system. Okay, class actions. I'm sure you all know class action is when a group of people who are similarly situated band together to sue either one or several defendants. And in federal courts and also in state courts, but maybe to a somewhat lesser extent, there are real serious limitations on the circumstances under which a case can be certified as a class action. The principal one is that the common issues have to predominate over the individualized issues that would surround the plaintiff's claims. Class actions, and this is my perspective as a defense lawyer, but class actions raise real risks of depriving parties of their property, depriving defendants of their property arbitrarily, because it's not always so easy to tell if all of these people really have valid claims, right? I mean, if you think of a fraud class action, it's not always so easy to tell if every single class member really heard the defendant's representations, relied on those representations, whether they're all really injured, the extent of their injuries. Those things are not always so easy to determine on a class-wide basis. And class actions also raise a real pressure on defendants to settle because the prospect of having damages awarded to thousands of people in one fell swoop is very frightening to defendants. So the key point in a class action is the point of certification. Those two are related, so I wanted to give that quick overview. But arbitration. So in the last few terms, the court has taken a number of arbitration cases. 3 terms ago, the court held in AT&T versus Concepcion that if an arbitration agreement says that all claims will be arbitrated and that they will not be arbitrated on a class-wide basis, that provision is enforceable. The plaintiffs had argued, well, it's not enforceable, it can't be enforceable, because if we can't arbitrate these claims as a class, they're too small to be brought individually, and so we won't have any way to bring our claims. It involved, you know, $30 and $40 claims that people were bringing against AT&T under their wireless contracts. And the court said, no, people can band together and share costs and do all that kind of thing without having a class action, and we're going to hold that these terms are enforceable. Last term, in a case called American Express versus Italian Colors Restaurant, the court reaffirmed that and said whether the plaintiff's claims arise under federal law or state law, these provisions are enforceable. So these cases show that the court is really serious about this commitment to arbitration as something that Congress and the court are in favor of. Another issue that comes up a lot in arbitration cases is who decides certain questions. So should these questions be decided by a court or by the arbitrator? And even though the court generally favors arbitration, these who decides questions can be very thorny and often come out in ways that defendants in favor of arbitration don't like. So last term in Oxford Health Plans versus Sutter, the court found that where an arbitrator construes a contract and says, look, it looks like the parties did agree that class-wide arbitration would be okay, that's enforceable because the arbitrator has the power to construe the contract. But the court dropped a footnote saying that Oxford, the defendant who didn't want class-wide arbitration, had raised this as a question about construction of the contract, which is something that an arbitrator can do, and that if Oxford had raised this as an issue about whether, in fact, these claims were arbitrable, then maybe a court would have to decide it, because generally speaking, arbitrators don't get to decide whether something is arbitrable, which goes to sort of a bigger theme in the law that people don't usually get to decide their own power unless they're a federal agency. So another case last term called Nitrolift versus Howard, the court held that attacks on the validity of a contract as opposed to the validity of an arbitration clause should be resolved by an arbitrator. Again, contracts can be handled by the arbitrator, but whether something is arbitrable usually cannot. The court's going to follow up on that this term in a case called BG Group versus Argentina. There's this treaty between Argentina and England, which provides protections to investors in each country that invest in the other country. BG Group is a British investor who had invested in Argentina, and after the Argentine economy went to pot in the late 90s, early 2000s, BG sued and said that Argentina had not held up its end of the bargain. And BG went straight to arbitration, notwithstanding the fact that the treaty says that first what you really need to do is go to a court in Argentina and give them 18 months to resolve your dispute. BG said, look, that's not possible, because they're not going to hear our case, and they're just going to make us wait, and they're going to impose all these penalties on us, and you should just let us go to arbitration. And the arbitrator said, you know what? We're looking at this jurisdictional issue, and we agree with you. We don't think it's really possible for you to litigate this in Argentina, and we're just going to arbitrate. And it awarded and ended up allowing the arbitration and awarding BG a lot of money. So Argentina took it to court. And now the issue before the U.S. Supreme Court is, who decides whether they had to meet this statutory prerequisite to arbitration? Is that something that the arbitrator can determine, or is that something that a court has to resolve? And there's a split among the lower federal courts on this issue, so everyone's watching very carefully to see what the U.S. Supreme Court will do. So back to class actions very briefly. Class actions, what the court has been looking at the last few terms and will continue to look at, I think, is the circumstances under which a class can be certified. As I mentioned, that is the key decision point in a class action. After a class is certified, the defendants almost always settle. So the real issue is what you have to do to get a case certified. So last term, the big case was Comcast Corp versus Berend, where the court held that in order to get a class certified, a plaintiff has to show that damages can be resolved on a class-wide basis. If damages are going to have to be done individually, then there's really not that much point in having this as a class action, and the plaintiff can't show that common issues predominate. The court also decided a case called Amgen versus Connecticut Retirement Plans, which kind of came out the other way. The court held in that case that a securities plaintiff does not need to show that the defendant's representations were material in order to get a class certified. Material obviously means that a reasonable investor would rely on those, would think that those statements were important. And the court said you don't have to prove that at the class cert stage. Securities class actions are maybe the most common kind of class actions, and that's not surprising because if you think about like a product liability case, there's going to be a lot of differences in the way that people bought the product, used the product, why they bought the product, how they were injured by the product. In a securities case, the investors basically all bought the securities on the same market. There's a presumption that the market incorporated all of the available information, so people don't usually have to prove reliance. And these cases tend to lend themselves to, you know, the class action format. At the same time, there's a lot of abuse, because if stock price drops, a lot of the time the plaintiff's bar will file a securities lawsuit, whether or not there's any real reason to believe that the stock price drop resulted from some misrepresentation coming to light, or just other factors about the company or about the economy. So there have been a series of statutes that have been designed to rein in securities class actions and sort of place controls over how they can be certified and where they can be brought. There's generally a policy in favor of bringing these cases in federal law because securities are generally regulated under federal law. So this term, the court has taken a trio of cases that all address basically a statute that mainly requires that securities class actions be brought in federal court. It's called the Securities Litigation Uniform Standards Act. And that statute basically says that when a case is brought in connection with securities that are regulated under federal law, the case has to be brought in federal court. The cases are kind of interesting, more interesting than they sound, because they all arise out of the Allen Stanford Ponzi scheme. And he probably doesn't have much money left, so people are trying to sue the law firms that represented him and the brokers through which they bought the securities. And so the big issue is whether these should be in federal court and also whether the law firms can be sued as aiders and abettors of this alleged, obviously, aiders and abettors of this Ponzi scheme. So I think the business community is watching that pretty closely because obviously companies, or maybe not so obviously, but generally speaking, companies would much rather these cases take place in federal court.
Thank you. So, and everybody's still on time. So I want to say a couple of thematic things about the court to perhaps answer the question I put at the beginning and that follow on some of the things that the other panelists said. And then I want to talk about one particular area, the Fourth Amendment, and just mention a couple of interesting cases that are coming to the court. So, you know, I think Adam's right, actually, to correct me and suggest that whether it's minimalist or not, it's incrementalist. I think what you see with the Roberts Court is that the court plants seeds that come to fruition down the road and raises this question of whether the left side of the court are
savvy or suckers.
I think I know the answer. But you know, I'm a little bit curious at the same time because as I watch the docket, every year the Supreme Court, there are these Supreme Court previews, and everybody talks about how exciting the Supreme Court term is going to be, and that's not surprising because journalists actually make money, or media makes money from getting you all excited about something. But I still think, over the run of the Roberts Court, there's been a lot of fizzling that goes on by the end of the term. And I'm curious about the fizzling phenomenon and why it happens. So the Fisher case is sort of an example. And I wonder whether part of it isn't the disjunction between the fact that it takes 4 votes to grant cert and 5 votes to decide the case. And so there's an eager 4 somewhere on the court for all these cases, but maybe not a majority. And also the Chief Justice has been doing what he says, which is trying to move the court, see that the court moves more slowly. And we've gotten a number of these decisions that have managed to attract big cuts of the bench, the left and the right alike, to do something that's more minimalist and might eventually be a seed for something that happens down the road. But I've also been curious often about how much of what's happening with the Roberts Court gets hidden behind what we're watching. So it's natural that we all watch 5 cases or 8 cases. That's more cases than most of us can possibly pay attention to during a term. And I've always been curious about, well, what's happening when we're not paying close attention, or is the court doing something in ways that we don't often see? So I'll say one thing about the business cases that maybe will provoke a conversation between the two of you, and then something about the Fourth Amendment where I'm very focused. So I got a bunch of research assistants here at NYU together one term, and we decided to look at the docket, this is a couple terms ago, and look at the docket for the cases that weren't in the news and say, which of these cases look like things where if you know you had a solid 5 votes on the right on the court, you might keep things quiet on the high-profile cases, but you'd grab for all the gusto in all the other cases. And particularly, there were lots and lots of business cases. And we made a list of all the ones that might matter to business. And as the term came to an end, we found that lots of those cases were decided in a left-leaning or liberal, I hate the labels, way, instead of a conservative way, though I think it might matter which cases you look at instead of which way they came out. But one of the questions I think I'm going to want to ask Adam and Lauren is we've heard a lot about the business agenda of the Roberts Court and you know whether there's a clear trajectory in favor of business or whether it's a much more mixed story. In the Fourth Amendment area, what I see happening with the Roberts Court, and I think you do have to be looking very closely, is you see a happy story coming from the Roberts Court, which is that the justices, you know, including some very conservative justices, are surprisingly protective of rights. And so, you know, we get the GPS tracking case from 2012, the Jones case, and the court holds that the government can't engage in long-term GPS tracking, or we had some dog sniff cases this term, and the court holds that the police can't bring dogs up to your house and sniff for drugs. And so everybody thinks, well, it's good to know that the Supreme Court's protecting our liberties. But in fact, I don't think that's what's happening at all. I think that the decisions are very bad, but you have to be watching quite closely to understand how they're bad. So the GPS tracking case is bad because Justice Scalia decided that if the government physically, writes for a majority saying if the government physically attaches a GPS tracking device to your car, then that's a common law trespass. But you know what happens when they don't have to physically attach the device, which is what's going on with our cell phones or OnStar on people's cars. And there, it's less clear what the court's going to do. Justice Alito, writing for a 4-justice concurrence, says, "Well, you know, technology. We just get used to it. Maybe the price of technology is that we have to just accept that the government's going to be more intrusive. And gosh, won't Congress do something to help all of us?" And so, you know, in the long run, it's not clear that it's rights protective. The dog cases are another example. The real important dog case last term was not the case about bringing dogs up to sniff at people's front doors, because that doesn't happen that much, and one hopes won't, or we now know won't happen much at all. But another case called Florida versus Harris, in which the question was, do the dogs and their trainers have to comply with minimal training standards before the dog sniffs can be used as probable cause to search people? And it matters a lot, because it turns out the dogs actually turn out to be terrifically good at what they do, the trainers not so much. And because the dogs don't speak English, the trainers get confused and all kinds of bad things happen. The other problem is the dogs turn out to be too good, so there may be drugs there, but there also may have been drugs there a week ago or a month ago, and the dog still smells it. But what the court holds, and again, it's what, you know, Justice Kagan writes for a very happy we're all together in this court, is no, we don't want to have standards. You know, you should feel free in every case to try the issue of whether the dog and trainer knew what they were doing, but we don't want to have minimal standards or impose them on the state or even uphold the minimal standards that the state Supreme Court itself put in place, and I think that's a bad thing. So I'm going to just mention 2 Fourth Amendment issues, and then I'll subside for your questions. The cases are interesting for very, very different kinds of reasons. So the first case, which is called Fernandez versus California, involves the following problem. The police knock on the door. They'd like to search the house. There are 2 people present, one of whom says, sure, and the other person says, no way. So what are the police supposed to do? And the Supreme Court decided a few terms ago in a case called Randolph that the answer is if somebody says no, the police can't search. So that's a bummer if you're the police. So what do you do? So what you do is you arrest the person who says no, and then they're not there anymore, and then the other person says yes, and everything's okay. And so the question in Fernandez is, does that work? And it's a great question, and the circuits are split. But what's really interesting about the case is that I misrepresented Randolph a little bit. So Randolph's a 5-4 decision that says, you know, if the person says no, you can't search. But really the court is 4-1-4. So 4 justices say, it doesn't matter if somebody says no, go ahead and search. That was the dissent. Four justices say if somebody says no, you absolutely can't search. That was the majority. Justice Breyer joined the majority saying no, but then wrote his own opinion saying, well, maybe. And this is a phenomenon that I'm writing an article with an NYU grad that we call pivotal concurrences, which is what happens if one of the justices in the constituting a majority, or two of the justices, whatever it takes to make a majority, then write another opinion that seems to say something different than the majority opinion. You know, which one governs? Well, the Supreme Court has been clear that the answer is if you've got five or more votes, that governs. But lower courts are not stupid, and they can count. And so they know that one of those votes that they need for the majority rule is shaky. And Justice Breyer is shaky in this case, and I suspect he's so shaky that the answer is going to be it's perfectly fine to remove somebody from the house and then go ahead and search. The other case or cases are cases called Riley and Worry, both of which have not been granted yet, but people think may well be granted. And they raise the fascinating question of whether the police can search a cell phone when they arrest you. So there's a doctrine that says that incident to a lawful arrest, the police can search your person or the area around you to look for contraband that might get destroyed or a weapon that could injure the police. But in these cases, what happens is the police take the cell phone and then often later on down the road start to look through the cell phone, and both have kind of wacky fact patterns that lead to the police finding that the person that they'd seized had committed a far more serious crime than they'd been arrested for. And the question is, can the police search the cell phone in this way? After all, there's not a lot of chance that the cell phone's gonna jump out and attack the police after the fact. And there are many ways, including, I'm told, just wrapping the phone in aluminum foil that will keep anybody from wiping the phone remotely while the police have it, so you could go get a warrant. So the question is, if the court takes these cases, what is it going to do? And I can tell you what I think it's going to do, which is it's going to hold that if the cell phone is believed to contain evidence of the crime for which somebody's arrested, they can look at the cell phone, but if it doesn't contain, there's no reason to think the phone contains that kind of evidence that they can't, and so that's my guess. I'm gonna stop because we wanna hear from you. So I know there are microphones, and I'm gonna ask you to raise your hand and if you wanna ask a question. And as that starts to happen, I'm actually gonna turn to Adam and Lauren and just say, so what about the business cases in the Roberts Court? What's the story? Is the Roberts Court aggressively pro-business as we hear, or not the case? Or does Lauren think it is and that's a good thing, and Adam thinks that it is and that's maybe not a good thing?
No, I don't think it is, actually. I don't think that the court is pro-business. I think if you look at, I would love to see your analysis of the sort of lesser known cases. I do an analysis every year of the cases that have a business on one side and an individual or the government on the other side. And last year was a great term for business interests, no doubt about it. The business interests won 2/3 of those cases that fit my criteria. However, those cases don't break down along partisan lines. Something funny happens in the business cases. They get resolved based on kind of neutral principles of law, and they really are not about whether we like corporations or whether we like class actions. They really tend to be about the narrower principles in the cases, and you see some very odd lineups based on some of these background rules of law that are at play in these cases. Another thing that I would say is that these business cases are very incremental. That American Express case that I was talking about flowed straight out of Concepcion. Comcast was straight out of the court's decision in Dukes v. Walmart from 2 terms ago. So I think a lot of these cases are very non-controversial. A lot of them are very lopsided majorities. Many of the business cases are 9-0 or 8-1 or 8-0 if Justice Kagan is recused. So I don't think you can look at the business cases and see these lopsided 5-4 conservatives on one side, liberals on the other kinds of lineups that you see in a lot of the other kinds of cases.
So you have to listen carefully to what Lauren was saying. She concedes that this is a pro-business court. She just says it's a lopsidedly pro-business court. And I think there's no difference between us. But who cares whether it's 5-4 or 9-0? This is the most pro-business court since the Second World War. It's beyond dispute. If you believe in the tools of political science, I refer you to a really careful study by Lee Epstein at USC and Bill Landis at Chicago and Judge Posner, which shows that the Roberts Court is easily the most pro-business court since the Second World War. And the two justices in all those years, scores of justices, most likely to vote in favor of business interests, number one, Justice Alito, number two, Chief Justice Roberts.
No questions? There's a hand over there, the gentleman in the blue shirt.
What do you guys think about the recess appointments case?
So just to give you a little bit of background, you recall the president has the power to fill up vacancies during the recess of the Senate. The immediate question before the court is whether a very brief recess, a pro forma recess, is the kind of recess the president can take advantage of. But when the question goes to the D.C. Circuit, the D.C. Circuit issues a much broader ruling saying what the terms "the recess" mean in the Constitution are that brief recess which takes place between sessions, which essentially invalidates, at least in theory, more than a century of practice of recess appointments. So the Supreme Court has taken both kinds of questions, that very broad D.C. Circuit question, the narrower pro forma session question. And the hard thing for the justices will be, they'll be inclined to rule against the president on the narrow question, on whether a three-day recess where there's some pro forma business going on is the kind of recess that would allow him to make a recess appointment. But if that's all the court decides, it may be that the D.C. Circuit, and that's where the action is, ruling stays in place. So they may have to figure out a way either to reach the merits of that very interesting larger question, the textual question, or whether they find some way to do a judicial somersault and vacate the D.C. Circuit decision on that second point without reaching the merits.
Good, thank you, Adam. The gentleman in the orange shirt, nobody over here has a question?
So I guess my question is sort of in relation to talking about Justice Roberts and you know, the reference to him trying to lessen the partisanship or the perceived ideology of the court. And I guess sort of, do you think that is one of the reasons for these sort of very specific limited rulings that don't really go into the background or go into the rationale? You know, by way of example, one of the popular theories when the Obamacare ruling came down was that Roberts switched his vote because, and I don't know if this is true or not, but one of the theories is that he switched his vote in order to make it seem, make the court seem less ideologically driven, and that his rationale of it being a tax was kind of this convenient cover for it. I'd be interested if you have opinions whether you think that's true or not, but do you think that also these limited rulings are a way for them to lessen the ideology without getting into the rationale?
So I'm going to ask everybody up here if they'd like to respond, but most likely Adam. But does anybody have hands? Anybody? No? So, okay. Adam?
The court, and the Chief Justice in particular, as the steward of the court, cares very much about its authority, prestige, institutional integrity. And if it's thought to be too political, that's bad for the court. And the court's approval ratings have recently been sinking dramatically, along with the rest of government. But whereas I always thought that the court, not as high as the military, but substantially higher than the other branches of the government, was the status quo, in recent times it's neck and neck with the president in the low 40s. So I think the court and the Chief Justice in particular care about those perceptions. It doesn't like to think of itself as acting politically. And I think there is a lot of explanatory force to the Chief Justice's decision for the only time in his entire career to join a bare majority with just the liberals to uphold the Affordable Care Act might have, among the many factors, including authentic legal reasoning, might have figured in his decision to put away a little political capital at the age of 58 or so for what will be a very long run on the court, where he can achieve a lot without blowing out the reputation of the court in an election year with a 5-4 all Republicans in the majority, all Democrats in dissent, striking down a Democratic president's signature legislative achievement. That would have been quite a headline.
Yeah, so though I want to push you on that just a little bit, though I think I ultimately agree with you, only to say it's a little bit the dog's tail wagging the dog to say that, the Obamacare case comes down the way it does because of the general reputational rankings of the court. I mean, I think that the Chief Justice has to calculate because after all, it was a big program that maybe the right side of the court thought, would be changing society in fundamental ways and wanted to stop. But I think it had to be more that he really thought a serious blow would, the court would incur a really serious expense if they had struck down the law.
I don't think we're saying different things. I think we agree.
Got it. So right here, if we could have a mic. And, I should have said this earlier, but if you would stand up and let us know who you are, that'd be great.
Yeah, my question is on the same line.
Or not. This is Pasquale Pasquino.
Yeah, it's on the same line. And in fact, can we come back to the point made at the very beginning by Barry? So the Chief Justice seemed to have an agenda at the beginning. Is he fulfilling his projects? And more specifically, in such a divided court, can he really avoid that we think that this is the Kennedy court rather than the Roberts court?
So on the last point first, there's some data is good to have. So Kennedy is in the majority far more than any other justice, and certainly far more than any other justice in 5-4 decisions. But the chief is second. So the chief cares about this. There were 30% of the court's cases, of its 72 or so cases last year, were 5-4. 70% of those were the classic ideological split, Kennedy plus liberals, Kennedy plus conservatives. And Kennedy was with the conservatives 10 times and 4 times with the liberals. So that gives you a sense of the general direction of this court. And without question, Kennedy's vote is the most important one. But Kennedy, I don't think, is a strategic actor. Kennedy is in the waning years of his service. He's building his legacy. He's very pleased with his gay rights decision. And I don't think he's trying to look down the road 20 years. I think Roberts is, as Barry suggests, that guy. But I don't overread these fairly bland statements that he makes. It's good to have a lot of, you know, unanimity, and we don't want to be polled. That's what you say at a confirmation hearing. That's what you say in an interview. He, in fact, like all of us, has commitments that he would like to see over time. He cares a lot about race. He cares a lot about campaign finance. He cares a lot about criminal procedure. And he's a very smart, savvy, patient man. And over time, he's going to do what he can to move the court in that direction. And if, oh my God, that's, you know, 5-4 decisions, I don't know that I don't know that he's broken a promise to us.
So it makes me want to ask Debo a question about the affirmative action cases, because, you know, if any case surprised me in terms of its fizzle, it was Fisher. I thought Grutter was going down. I thought that the notion that we were going to keep this space for affirmative action for diversity reasons, with, you know, the caveat that it couldn't be the factor but one of factors, was seriously in jeopardy. And I was pretty surprised at how Fisher came out. You have any thought about why, or, you know, what's going on there?
So I think this is a version of what Adam described in his response to whether this is a Roberts or a Kennedy court. There are actually sort of three camps, broadly speaking, on the race cases in the court. There is a camp that is skeptical of the continuing project and the role of civil rights statutes in addressing these problems, for whatever reason. They, in their opinions, have a fair degree of skepticism about the reach of these statutes and the effect of their implementation. Then there is another camp, which may be comprised of a very small number of justices, that is not as skeptical about the continuing importance of this mission to eradicate racial discrimination in the country, but is deeply skeptical of the remedies, of the approach, of the way that we address racial discrimination. And the final camp is the camp that is still quite focused on it and concerned about it, and believes that there is vigorous and broad work to continue to be done. And so that middle camp, which may or may not include Justice Kennedy, has to grapple with how these cases play out in a particular circumstance. And he has over and over again written opinions where he says that we've made progress, but there are still issues. In one of his early rulings, early in the Chief Justice's time on the court, there was a Voting Rights Act ruling where Justice Kennedy and Justice Roberts were sort of going back and forth at each other about the continuing salience of voting discrimination under a different provision of the Voting Rights Act, not the one that was at issue last term. And Justice Kennedy pointed to the long history of racial discrimination in voting. That case arose in Texas, the continuing impact that it has, and essentially he was saying that we have further to go in this area. He's had many other rulings, or if not many, certainly other rulings that one could point to, where he says the same thing. And so what I think happened in Fisher was at the end of the day, the plaintiffs were not, they did not frame their case as a frontal attack. They framed it as a as an incremental attack that was pitched to this court to try and get the case up there as a vehicle, which they thought, because of the way the court rules, may the snowball might start rolling down the hill and may become something bigger. But because of the different lineup of the justices on the court, I think we found ourselves in that middle space where probably Justice Kennedy was not yet willing, even though he has expressed some skepticism of remedies in the area of affirmative action, was not yet willing to go there. And so we have a next chapter and not a final chapter.
I thought Justice Breyer had a very cogent analysis. He was asked what went on in Fisher. What was your reaction? Why did you join this decision that may have tightened up the rules a little bit? And his entire analysis was this: phew. Which is to say, we dodged the bullet, and if we can kick this can down the road, we may have a different set of personnel next time the issue comes before us.
Okay, so that raises at least two things that I'd like to say, but again, I want to invite you to throw your arm in the air if you have a question. There's a woman right here who has a question. But let me just open up a couple of things before we get to the question, which is, one about the membership of the court, right? So it is, I mean, Justice Ginsburg's made clear she's not going anytime soon, though there are people who think that perhaps she should to make sure that the president has the ability to fill that seat. But should something happen to the right of the court, there is a chance for this flip, and I'm curious about the extent to which the justices may be willing to kick the can down the road, because otherwise it seems to me that what we're getting is a lot of kicking the can down the road that is, you know, slowly moving the law in a bad direction. And I suppose you could do it in one hop or in five hops, but if you don't like the way the law is going, you'd want to stop it at some point. The other is your point about Justice Kennedy and, you know, what happens in the middle of the court, and raises a remedy question that I think applies to a lot of what the Roberts Court does, which is, you know, I don't take Justice Kennedy to be entirely sincere, or I take him to be sincere, but maybe wrong-minded, right? So he says in all these cases, race matters and things are not so great, and I don't like this plan, but, you know, if something else could happen, it would be okay as a remedy. But I always read his decisions, I'm thinking particularly of Parents Involved, where he's part of the court that's saying that we can't have these race-conscious allocations to high schools, as imagining some remedy that can't happen in the real world. So it's great to feel bad about a problem and say there'll be some solution, but if that solution can't ever happen, then there's not going to be any recourse. And I even, you know, I wonder with the business cases as well, you asked about, you know, what we found, and I think Adam actually said this the other day, across the range of the business cases, they may go in a variety of directions, but in the important ones about access to the courts, I think that the plaintiff's side of the bar is taking it on the chin very often. And that seems to me to be, again, that the Roberts, I mean, I'm perplexed by the Roberts Court. I can't tell whether not much is happening, whether they're very sneaky and we can't all catch it. But it seems to me that a lot of it happens in sort of remedies and access and things like that that are not so easy to capture in headlines. And so there's room to be gained. So why don't I let you say something about that, and then we'll go to this question.
You can tell I'm itching to respond to that. Yes. Well, on this access to courts point, I think that there is this somewhat of a misconception that the Roberts Court is sort of slamming shut the courthouse door. A lot of these decisions that do relate to access are, in our view at least, really reining in some fairly obvious abuses by the plaintiff's bar. So last term, in a case called Standard Fire versus Knowles, the plaintiff was trying to evade the impact of something called the Class Action Fairness Act by stipulating no class had been certified. This person stipulated that the class as a whole, these people that the plaintiff didn't represent yet, would never seek damages in excess of a certain number. And the court said the plaintiff can't stipulate that, the class rep. I mean, they don't. This person doesn't represent these other people. How can this person say none of these other people who I don't represent yet will ever seek damages in excess of X amount? So it's not surprising that the court said, you know, you can't do that. In another case called Genesis Healthcare Corp. versus Simchick, the defendant offered to settle the plaintiff's claims in full for the amount that the plaintiff sought. And the plaintiff said, yeah, okay, but I'm not gonna take your settlement even though you're offering me the exact amount that I asked for in my complaint because I still wanna have this class action. And it probably wasn't the individual plaintiff who was making this decision, it was probably the lawyers. So I think a lot of the time these access to courts cases are really about reining in some of these abuses on the part of lawyers and not something that is intended to close the courthouse doors to actual people.
Um, So my name is Sarah Langer-Zavich. I'm a 1L, and I'm curious about the Hobby Lobby case. When the rule came out, some of the reaction, so like the Blunt Amendment that was introduced in the Senate by Senator Blunt, wasn't just about contraception. It was about, you know, can employers deny really coverage of just about anything for any moral or religious objection. Do you see the court, you know, under the incrementalist paradigm, dealing just with contraception and just with employers like Hobby Lobby, or do you see potentially broader questions being dealt with and answered?
Adam, maybe give us three sentences about
so,
what's
so Hobby Lobby is this contraception mandate case we're talking about. That's one of several, a couple of cases which have just now reached the court about whether that part of the Affordable Care Act violates the religious liberty of secular for-profit corporations. So I in a way, I want to flip the answer. It's not so much that they might want to be planting seeds in such a case. It's that they might want to rule in favor of these corporations, but not know how to do it on a basis that doesn't make every religious or its claimed religious sentiment everywhere a way to get around of complying with federal law. And of course, this would not necessarily bother the right side of the court. The next logical step is laws that require that gay people be treated fairly. So anti-discrimination laws where the photographer doesn't want to go take a picture at a same-sex marriage, you know, that would be very much the same logic as this Hobby Lobby case.
Other questions? Yeah, so while we move the mic over there, I just want to follow up with one question for you, Adam, which is that, actually, I'm going to wait till after the question because I might want to ask you to describe McCutcheon, because I do think that that I have an issue about corporations and corporate rights, and then I also have an issue about things moving incrementally. Yep.
Hi, I'm Kristen. I'm a 1L. I had a question about what I think you opened the discussion with about the idea in the voting rights case about treating states fairly and how that doesn't really have a constitutional basis. And I'm wondering, do you see this idea influencing any cases coming up, and also whether the panelists see any connection, there is a connection between this and the idea of state dignity that played a role in having the DOMA case this past term?
It's such a good question that I'm going to let Debo answer it.
thank you, Adam. I appreciate that. Well, obviously, I think Adam was giving a short answer to frame the issue. Obviously, there is a very strong structural concept of the role of states in the Constitution. What I think Adam's principal focus, and I would argue many of the people that have criticized the decision, is that the Reconstruction Amendments were specifically passed and given enforcement provisions that were designed to restructure the relationship between the federal government and the states based upon a very specific history of the mass deprivation of rights. And so I've heard it said before that the 11th Amendment is not the 11th Amendment, right? That the 14th and 15th Amendments come after, and that history that led to the passage of those amendments tells us something about the restructuring of these of the arrangement between the federal government and the states. It doesn't mean that the states don't have an important role to play. It does mean in certain circumstances, to wit the area of racial discrimination in voting, Congress itself has a special role to play, and the Constitution has been amended to vest Congress with the principal enforcement power to enforce that mandate. And what you didn't see in the opinion was a lot of discussion about that history and about the precedents that run clearly through the Reconstruction precedents. There's an important Rehnquist opinion in a case called Fitzpatrick against Bitzer, where he has very strong language about how the Reconstruction Amendments were an intentional restructuring and reallocation of power to the federal government as against the states. And you just didn't see that in the ruling. And so this idea about the sovereignty or the dignity of states, loosely conceived in the face of an express amendment designed to reorder things in the face of a specific problem with a demonstration of the continuity of that problem, is where the decision starts to rankle people. And I think Judge Posner wrote a critique that was similar to what Adam laid out, that, you know, he said that he wasn't aware of the basis on which the court decided the ruling, in part because it's not in the Constitution. And so as to the second part, will this idea of the dignity of states have a longer shadow in cases that we come to see? It's sort of interesting because I think there are many of us who think that was Chief Justice Rehnquist's project in some respect, that he was more of a federalism guy than perhaps the Chief Justice. That's not to say that all the justices don't care about these various doctrines and structural understanding of the Constitution, but it seemed to be more visceral for the last Chief Justice. This Chief Justice, as my co-panelists have suggested, is sort of focused in other areas. So from where I sit, I don't know how many legs the Shelby County ruling will have in that context, because there is a sense in which that statute is sui generis. There are not a lot of statutes that focus the federal power on some states and not others expressly in that way. And so, you know, the ideas will be out there in other cases. There will continue to be tension between the role of the federal government and the states. But I don't see the specific ruling in Shelby County necessarily shaping that, except in a rhetorical way.
Though there is, I agree with everything Debo said, and I think that federalism was the Rehnquist Court's project, but there's a fascinating federalism case up there this term that I was actually assigned to mention if there was time, so I will. And it definitely echoes the ACA decision in some way. It's a case called Bond versus United States, and it's the second time it's been up to the court. So there's a woman who learns that her husband has impregnated another woman, and she's very angry, and she gets some chemicals and she sprinkles them around the mailbox and the car of the other woman, and it's an ill-conceived plot. The chemicals are bright orange. It's hard not to miss them. The only injury that's sustained is a chemical burn to the woman's thumb. Still a crime, still serious, but the interesting thing is that she's prosecuted by the federal government, not by the states, and this strikes, you know, one as very classically sort of a state crime, but the federal government prosecutes under a statute called the Chemical Weapons Convention Implementation Act. So it's a statute passed pursuant to a treaty, and there's a lot of agreement, though now the federal government is not so sure, but that this is not power Congress might have under the Commerce Clause to make the use of these chemicals a crime, though the government again now is arguing that there is this commerce power just in case. But the question is, even if there isn't the power under the regular enumerated powers, can Congress still do something under the treaty power? Can it take an agreement with other countries and use that as the basis for legislation that it otherwise couldn't enact? And that's a fascinating question. It's a question that some see as, you know, that way you could use the treaty power as a way to make an end run around the enumerated powers. It's a little complicated because there also seems to be agreement that if it's a self-executing treaty, it's a treaty that when it's ratified by the Senate actually becomes the law of the land. It's written in a way that we already know what the law is. You don't have to pass implementing legislation. That's okay, so it's only for non-self-executing treaties, which is what most of them are. So we'll see what the justices do with that. But Rick Pildes had a wonderful exchange on the Volok conspiracy about the case, and David Golub, I think, filed an amicus brief in the case. So the faculty's been very involved in that. Any other questions? Yes, there are hands right here.
We are seeing the judge of the Supreme
Tell
Court.
Tell us who you are.
Coming in.
Your name?
I am a JD. I'm an LLM student, Dimitris Paderakis.
Thank you.
We're seeing the justices in the Supreme Court appointed there at an increasingly younger age. And some of them have a very small track record in the Court of Appeals. For example, Chief Justice John Roberts served only 2 years before being appointed as a Chief Justice. How does that affect the future of the Supreme Court?
They're not actually being appointed at a younger age by historical standards. 50 has been the median age for a long time, but they live longer. So you have a different kind of problem. And John Roberts.
We can solve that problem. Mandatory retirement age.
Oh.
Even if I thought that, I wouldn't announce it on
I disassociate myself with whatever he meant. Roberts, the truth is that the current court is full of exceptionally able lawyers. And while John Roberts was only on the D.C. Circuit for a little while, he was the principal deputy solicitor general. He is, you know, whatever you have to say about John Roberts' lack of skill and track record in the sense of assessing whether he's up to the job was not one of the problems.
Though I'll note, Adam, just because you're at a school which has a huge number of LLMs, that is, you know, it's a very different tradition in the United States from other countries in terms of the path to the Supreme Court. So it's quite natural in many other countries for people to be chosen from the lower courts. And it's actually interesting. There's been somewhat more of that going on in recent years as a vetting mechanism so that we all know how the judges are going to behave when they get there. And many people who think it's not a great idea. I think there was another question in the very back.
Hi, my name's Nick. I'm a 3L. And I was just curious if there's a way, if you think there's a way to explain the conservative justices' overtures to democracy and deference to Congress in any way other than an ideological bent. So in like ACA and Shelby County, you have them ignoring Congress completely, and yet in like the Windsor dissent or the arbitration cases, you have this deference to the legislative process. And I mean, is there a way to explain that besides just convenience for their ideologies? Or?
Why do you limit that to the conservative justices?
I don't.
except for Kennedy, there was an element of hypocrisy from Tuesday to Wednesday when, you know, some of the justices said we have to let Congress decide on the Voting Rights Act, and the next day those same justices said we can't let Congress decide DOMA, and vice versa. You know, it's hard to reconcile.
Adam, so Noel Canning, I mean, I thought about that in the context of the Noel Canning case.
That's the recess appointment case,
because, you know, it's Obama's appointees and frustrated with failing to get appointees through the Senate, and yet, you know, sometimes the president's a Republican and sometimes the president's a Democrat, and I wondered if you think sort of immediate politics influences or whether it's, you know, everybody has the understanding that we just don't know who's going to be president in the future.
That's a very good point, and I wonder about that, but the early atmospherics of the case are that it's taken on a very partisan cast and maybe a short-sighted one, because the next Republican president will be stuck with whatever powers get limited in that decision.
Any other questions? So, just because I care, I'm just looking to see if there are any women, since we've heard from a lot of men, but right, so the mic comes right here. Kate, you got one? Or Jonathan? Right here, fellow right here.
Hi, my name is Mitch, I'm a 1L. I'm just curious, kind of going back to the discussion before about arbitration and sort of that blocking the access to the courts. I'm curious the extent to which you think that extends to kind of the court's consideration of issues of standing and of jurisdiction, particularly in the same-sex marriage cases last year where the Supreme Court goes out of its way to consider this issue that none of the parties are really worried about discussing, nor really to a large extent were the lower courts. So curious, I guess, about that, looking back at those cases, then looking forward at the sort of the standing and jurisdictional cases that are coming up this term.
I don't know if anybody has a view. I mean, I think in the Prop 8 case, it was just to avoid the merits in any way that the court could. I do think, and you know, Lauren may have something to say about this. I mean, you might agree with me. Certainly, Iqbal and Twombly just fundamentally changed federal court practice, and those were certainly gatekeeper statutes, and all the 1Ls are learning about them. You're in the courts much more than I am. Is that your
impression? No, we had a case dismissed under Iqbal and Twombly yesterday. I mean, yes, those did, they changed the landscape, and they've had, I think, a very good effect on what's been going on in the federal courts.
Or a bad effect, depending on your perspective.
The case was maybe the best example of, I think, something Barry mentioned in passing, which is that it takes 4 votes to take a case, 5 votes to decide it, and it seemed pretty clear at the Prop 8 argument that there were at least 5 justices who said, what the hell were we thinking? Please keep this case away from us.
Good. There's a tiny bit of time, but maybe not enough that we won't end up keeping you, and I know you need to get to class. So I want to thank the panel. I think you've been great. Thank you all for coming.